So my name is Linda Stanton, and I'm a retired geriatric social worker. I worked for 27 years, postmaster's degree, mostly in affordable housing. I worked for the Wilder Foundation and Common Bond Communities. I've been on the Community Advisory Committee for the Gateway Corridor for the last 3 years. And I'm just really active in the community. I do a lot of letter writing. I see a lot of familiar faces, so you probably read some of my stuff in the Woodbury Bulletin or in the Pioneer Press. I live in Woodbury. And one of the reasons we had the cake tonight is because the committee worked really hard. We distributed about 1,800 postcards this last legislative session in an effort to stop the $3 million appropriation that they wanted to get for the match for the federal funds for the Gateway Corridor. So we didn't get a chance to have a celebration, so that's why we have the cake. So please have some cake. So after we kind of got excited about feeling like we found a lot of support at the legislature, feeling that they held the line on the funding for the Gateway, then we found out later that people were saying, well, we're just going to go to the Met Council, or we're just going to go to the County Transit Improvement Board to get the money. So that's where we got kind of frustrated. So that's why we're having this program tonight, to educate people about the Met Council and the kind of complicated structure of transit funding and the decision making in the Twin Cities. We felt like we had some success, and it wasn't all, we can't take credit for it. We really appreciate Lake Elmo putting a kibosh on it, because that saved a good portion of 4th Street. So if you're not familiar with 4th Street, it's just a really beautiful little place, and a lot of people have retired there. There's a senior living building and a lot of beautiful townhomes and older people that really, you know, don't like the idea of having a bus and the possible safety issues and just having their neighborhood be urbanized. So I'd like to introduce our panel. And I'm going to start down, I'm going to start with Frank. Okay. So on the end we have Frank Pafko. He is a retired 36-year state of Minnesota employee. He was 2 years at the DNR and 34 years at MnDOT. He has a BS degree in fisheries, and he became the environmental guy for MnDOT. He worked on environmental studies for transportation project development, obtaining permits, and policy development and implementation. He has 4+ years as a North Area Manager for the Metro District of MnDOT. He was responsible for highway project development in Ramsey, Anoka, and Northern Hennepin counties, and was the first non-engineer to hold such a position in MnDOT. Examples of his successful projects that he worked on are Unweave the Weave, which I found out was 694 and 35E, the I-94 and 3M bottleneck, and Highway 36 in North St. Paul, among many other projects. He was the first point of contact for local government, elected officials, and the public, therefore needing to translate engineer lingo into something that people can understand. Since retirement, he provided commentary on the transportation issues as a Transportation Tsar on the Up and Atom radio show. He also contributed a few thoughts on transportation and the Metropolitan Council to the Center of the American Experiment. Really appreciate Frank being here tonight. State Representative Linda Runbeck is in her 5th non-consecutive term in the Minnesota House, sandwiching an 8-year tenure in the State Senate. She currently represents District 38A, which includes portions of Anoka and Washington counties in the northern Twin Cities metropolitan area. Representative Runbeck chairs a House panel regarding Met Council reform and also serves on committees related to transportation, capital investment, state government finance, and government operations and elections. Representative Runbeck and her husband Richard live in Circle Pines. So I appreciate her encouragement this last session. She was very helpful. State Representative Jerry Hertas serves the Western Hennepin County area and was elected to the Minnesota House of Representatives in 2012. He He resides in Greenfield, Minnesota, where he served as mayor, as well as on the City Planning Commission. In the House of Representatives, he served on the Education Finance, Mining and Outdoor Recreation Policy, Public Safety and Crime Prevention Policy and Finance, and the Taxes Subcommittee on Property Tax and Local Government Finance Division. So, thank you. And last but not least, we have Scott Schulte. He was born and raised in Coon Rapids. He's married with 5 children and 9 grandchildren. Scott currently owns and operates a successful 58-year-old family-run old-fashioned service station, the High 10 Service, and has been employed there for 46 years. Scott has 12 years of service on the Coon Rapids City Council as Mayor Pro Tem and Councilman at Large. He currently is serving his second term as an Anoka County Commissioner, representing Coon Rapids, Anoka, and Andover. He has served his community in many other capacities on councils and associations, including the Law Enforcement Council and the Rotary Foundation, among other groups. He currently represents Anoka County on CTIB, the County Transit Improvement Board. I have a feeling I'm talking really fast. Okay, Representative Fenton just tried to sneak in, in the pink. All right, so I'm just going to start real quick and do an introduction about the Gateway Corridor. So how many people feel like they're real familiar with the Gateway Corridor? Okay, a good number of you. So I'm not going to go through a lot of the details, but we can maybe get to some of the questions, and Frank will probably answer a lot of those for you. So the main thing about the Gateway Corridor that you may know is that it's not your average bus rapid transit. It's basically a light rail on wheels. It just doesn't have the track, and it doesn't have the power lines. It has a guideway. It's 2 lanes just for the bus. And the route that has been proposed for the Gateway Corridor will go from the Union Depot. It used to be to Manning Avenue. Now it would take a turn onto Elmo. But the result of it would be that west of 61 into St. Paul, Hudson Road, so if you can imagine, it's Hudson Road just north of 94 all the way out to Elmo. Hudson Road would become one way, one lane going west. So anybody that lives on Hudson Road there would only be able to make a right turn out of their driveway or a right turn into their driveway. So they'd kind of have to go around the block to get to their house. The other thing that it would require would be when it gets to, so coming across the Kellogg Bridge is going to run in mixed traffic because the Kellogg Bridge is in need of repair and it couldn't handle a guideway. So then when it comes to 61, say you're going east, there would have to be a bridge that would fly over that kind of like little rotary there where 61 joins at Etna Street. Coming east at White Bear Avenue, it would require to have an underpass go under White Bear Avenue. Coming further along, when it gets to Century Avenue, it would require a bridge going over Century Avenue. Then it would come around Tanner's Lake, where it would run in mixed traffic because there's not enough room there to put a guideway. It would come up north on Hadley, turn right on 4th Street, cross the bridge, which is also in need of repair, not big enough, so it would run in mixed traffic on the bridge. And the favored plan that they have is to come down 4th Street and then turn right on Elmo. Probably have its own little exit ramp through the property there. Then it would connect to a new bridge, another bridge that would go across 94, connecting Elmo and Bielenberg. Go down Bielenberg to Woodbury 10 Theater, which we found out is owned by the Met Council. They don't run the theater, they rent it out or lease it out or something. So it could be that in the future there might be a park and ride at that Woodbury 10. The residents that you might know are really surprised about, they didn't feel like they knew anything about the plans here in Oakdale. So they were really kind of angry when they found out about it, because they felt like it would really impose on their neighborhood. So in spite of a lot of meetings where people felt like they were heard, they really felt like the decisions had already been made, that it wasn't going to change anything, although with Lake Elmo making the decision and people speaking up, I do feel like we have managed to save a good portion of the street from having the BRT imposed on it. If you're not from the area, if you do drive down there, it's really pretty. It's one of the nicest parts of Oakdale, in my opinion. So in the winter, we formed a 501c4 called Citizens for Smart Transit to try to keep the BRT off of 4th Street, or at least come up with a better option for the residents on 4th Street. And then our first campaign was the Save 4th Street campaign, and we still have some buttons if you'd like a button. And the goal was to stop the $3 million at the Capitol, because we got the impression that it was imperative that they have $3 million this session. And we thought, well, if they don't get the $3 million, then it's going to be finished, right? And my colleague, Bob, even told the commission that in June. I don't think they liked hearing it, but we said it anyway. We've been really fortunate that City Council member Paul Renke, he offered to meet with the group. So we've had a small group of about 10 residents, neighborhood leaders that have met with Paul like every other month. And he's gone over details and gotten feedback and gotten comments and things like that. But we haven't changed his mind yet, so we're working on it. So now we kind of feel like the only way to really stop the project on 4th Street would be to shut it down. I don't know if that's possible. We'd like to see an affordable option, something like maybe regular buses that drive on the roads that we already have. So that's my presentation. And what we'll do is we're gonna go, each person's gonna do a little introduction, and then we're gonna move to questions and answers to see what you guys would like to find out. So I think we're gonna start with Frank. Okay. You wanna come up here?
Hi.
It's up to you.
You wanna start? Yeah, I'll do that to start with, and we'll come back.
Linda said, my name's Frank Pafko, and I want to emphasize that I am retired MnDOT, and I in no way, shape, manner, or form talk for MnDOT or the Dayton administration, and after I'm done, you'll know why. I spent most of my career in the environmental office. So I got to know all the environmental rules and regulations. So I'm going to give you an angle as to how this project is developing and how they're justifying that in the environmental documents that they're working on. So the purpose, as reported by the Gateway Corridor Commission, the purpose of the Gateway Corridor project is to provide transit service to meet the existing and long-term regional mobility and local accessibility needs for businesses and the traveling public. The operative words in that paragraph, in that sentence, is provide transit service and to meet needs, not wants, needs. Then they go on and list five needs of this corridor. First one, limited transit service. Okay, I'll buy that. That's a legitimate transportation goal. And the next one, they say, well, there is a policy shift toward transit and multimodal investment, which you can paraphrase by saying, we want it. That's cool. That's a need. They want it. Then they're saying that there's increasing population and jobs in this corridor. And they're actually projecting in the next 15 years that there's going to be 70% more jobs out here. Last 15 years hasn't given us a 70% increase in jobs. So I don't know if the next 15 years are going to do it, but I'm skeptical. That there are transit-dependent people that don't have access to vehicles. Okay, I'll buy that too. You should be, I'm not opposed to transit. I think we do need to provide transit to people who are dependent upon that. Or in the case of downtown Minneapolis, they can't find a parking place to get to their job, so they gotta take the bus or the train. And then finally, there's local and regional objectives for growth and prosperity, which means they want to pick winners and losers. And I don't think a transportation project is needed to provide crony capitalism. That's what that need is. So what alternatives are they discussing to do this? We all know that BRT is their locally preferred alternative on an alignment. The EIS might, they might discuss one or two other alignment shifts, but basically in the same location. There's going to be no build, not doing the project, because environmental laws say you got to do no build. You cannot dismiss that until you get to the end of the process. They looked at LRT, light rail transit, and they eventually dismissed it because Met Council said there's no way there's going to be enough money for light rail transit out here. And, an alternative that they are studying, they didn't really want to, but Federal Highway Administration made them during scoping, is the managed lane, which is essentially add a couple of in-pass lanes to 94 in the downtown St. Paul. While they have pretty much said they're not going to do it, they need to finish their environmental document before they can dismiss it. And they've already, they're already on record as saying, we will discuss it, but we are not going to give it a full analysis compared to the bus rapid transit that they, the local alignment that they want. Then we get to cost. And one of the things, my parents were children of the Depression, and they taught, they were, they learned to be frugal, and they taught me to be frugal. So when I went into my job at MnDOT, particularly when I was area manager, I wanted to build the best project I could for the smallest, get the biggest bang for the smallest amount of buck. And so one of the things, and one of the things I'm very proud of, is the Unweave the Weave project, which is the system interchange between 694 and 35E. Functionally, it is exactly the same project as Crosstown Commons, which is Crosstown and 35W, near where I live in Richfield. And the Crosstown Commons project, I've never gotten a total cost, but it's in excess of $300 million to do that job. I did Unweave the Weave for about $120 million. And that's my philosophy. It's not to waste the taxpayers' dollar, but to do it. You can achieve 90% of the benefit for probably 15%, 20% of the cost. And the law of diminishing returns kick in after that. So, because of Lake Elmo's action, they had to move the alignment, they changed their eastern termini, and they actually cut 3 miles. They just announced they actually reduced the cost of the project. But they also cut the length of the project by 3 miles. So now, instead of a proposed exclusive busway coming in at $44 million a mile, they have kind of a combination exclusive busway and on existing streets for $51 million a mile. Remember that. 51, and they're actually saying we're going to have 3,000 bus riders a day in 2040. 3,000, okay. Which is actually, it could actually be considered a bargain when you figure that Southwest Light Rail is coming in at $125 million a mile, at least before they finish the project. That's at least going to do about 30,000 people a day. But that's still outrageously expensive. Highway 610 up in Maple Grove, the last new four-lane freeway that's going to be built on new alignment in the Twin Cities. Construction project left for $40 million a mile a couple years ago. Four freeway lanes, new alignment. A freeway lane will handle 2,200 vehicles an hour compared to 3,000 bus riders a day. And given that that was a construction cost, it's not a total project cost, but it's a comparable project. You can add those managed, you can add a lane to 94 in each direction for $5 to $10 million a mile. Nothing fancy, you're not doing anything else, you're just adding a lane. And if you would do other kinds of bus rapid transit, like the A line along Snelling Avenue, which is using existing streets and just adding stations and better buses, or the orange line along 35 W. Those are anywhere from $3 to $20 million a mile. And the biggest cost of the Orange Line is rebuilding the Lake Street 35W interchange, which has a lot more benefits than just bus or rapid transit. So there you go. They are, what they haven't discussed, and which nobody's talking about, in the highway business, we had always discussed transportation demand management alternative. And that might be improved bus service, doing some park and ride lots, doing a few other things to try to get the demand for freeway traffic down. Well, they aren't even talking about a travel demand management. And for a lot less than the cost of this project, they could add more, they could add more express buses on the shoulder of 94. They could add better stations for that express bus service. They could add better transit service in, you know, out on several lines out on the East Metro and provide much more service to those transit-dependent people who have limited transit service that meets the needs that they've identified for a lot less than almost a half $1 billion and $51 million a mile. So, if any of you are going to be commenting on the upcoming draft environmental impact statement, you just might want to ask, why aren't they studying a limited construction alternative with more existing bus routes and a little better amenities for the existing bus riders? Because that's probably what this corridor really needs, and that's what their needs and purpose and needs statement justifies. Thank you.
Good evening, Scott Schulte, Anoka County Commissioner, serving on the county's Transit Improvement Board. I'm not going to go on very long. I think we're going to be much more effective here answering your questions when the time comes than standing up here and pontificating. I'm here mostly to not opine on whether this is right or wrong, or even on the costs. I'm here to basically deliver to you statistics and facts. The county's Transit Improvement Board is a body made up of five counties: Anoka, Washington, Dakota, Hennepin and Ramsey. Carver and Scott both have seats on the board as ex officio members. They don't have votes because they don't collect a sales tax and contribute to the CTIB coffers. That quarter cent sales tax that's collected in each one of those counties is put into a pot that is used expressly for transit improvement, transit way improvements. It's not to be used for metro transit buses and that type of thing. It's specifically for trains, BRT, highway BRT. And it's used not only for capital, but it's also used for operations. When we build a line, CTIP will generally contribute 30%. I'm not quite sure why the gold line's at 35% from CTIP, but it is. Most lines get 30% of their capital dollars from CTIP, and then we pay 50% of operations going forward. Comes out of CTIP. CTIP is in disarray right now. Dakota County has announced they're dropping out. That's a pretty sizable dues loss. I'll use the word dues. It's a pretty sizable revenue loss for CTIB, which is going to limit what CTIB can do in the future. Our current revenue stream, our current outlook is we can build out Southwest and fund its operations, and we're close to being able to build out Bottineau and its operations. But that leaves Gateway on the outside looking in. Gateway does not have the necessary funding from CTIB if Dakota drops out. Anoka County has already said publicly, we're not far behind Dakota in dropping out. If CTIB decides to go to bonding, they decide to borrow money to pay for this stuff, Anoka County's gonna get out. We don't wanna be on the hook for any more bonds. Washington County has been paying into CTIB since 2008 and hadn't received a project. So early on, they said, hey, look, we're funding your Hiawatha line. We're funding your central corridor. What are we getting here? What are Washington County residents getting? And so a deal was struck with the executive board of CTIB and Washington County that they would get a payment in lieu of a project until such time that a project was available. So they were receiving, and I don't remember the exact amount, somewhere between $3 and $5 million a year was going into a pot for Washington County. Well, Gateway was their project. That's what was dreamed up to spend their money on was the Gateway. And whether it was, you know, through the alternatives analysis, whether it was a light rail or a bus rapid transit or whatever it might be, that's what that pot of money is used for. And that's what they've been using right now for a lot of their environmental analysis and studies and all the rest of it. So that's really where Gateway got its origin. Whether you believe in CTIB and its process or not really it isn't really important right now, because your county, Washington County, believes in CTIB and they think it's a good project, and they will continue to collect your quarter cent sales tax and put it into there. And again, that's between you and your county commissioners is whether you continue that project or not. I would suggest that one of our major issues in the area is the Metropolitan Council and its control over the seven county metro area. They are a 17-member unelected body appointed by our governor, and they are coterminous with the governor. As long as the governor's in there, the governor has control of that body. They are essentially a state agency, and they operate as a state agency. A number of us, five counties, five ring counties, got together 2.5 years ago and said, we need to work on this. We need to figure out a way we can either work with the Met Council or reform the Met Council to make it so they are either elected people, because they need to be accountable to the taxpayer. Currently, they are accountable to one person, and that's our governor. So in that process, Washington County chose at one point to pull out of this reform group. It was a decision they made, I believe, to protect their Gateway program, because CTIB and the governor would not be happy if Washington County was wanting to reform the body that could help fund their Gateway line. Anyway, we're working hard on that reform. We've come to some of your city councils. I think I was in Lake Elmo at one point, presented there, and a few other city councils out in this area, all of them in Anoka County. We presented and got resolutions of city councils that said that council needs reform. We went to our legislature. We worked with a great committee up at the legislature. We had some hearings. There was actually some Met Council reform legislation that was developing, and it got scaled like everything did last session, so we didn't move on that. But it's going to be a big deal in deciding how we move forward. One question I have for everybody that has anything to do with these lines, and I don't care if it's Hiawatha, I should be using them by the real name, the blue line, the green line, the blue line extension, the green line extension, or the gold line. My question is, what are we going to do in 30 years? Nobody, including the Metropolitan Council, has come up with a continuity plan. When these things wear out, when the catenary lines need to be replaced, when the cars need to be replaced, there is no continuity plan. It's got to be coming back to the taxpayer. It's got to be the answer. We got to reinvest this capital all over again. But it's not in the plan. They got operations in the plan. They got escalators in the plan for inflation, but they got nothing for replacement of product. Capital. I think that's a major deal. Other thing you need to know about the gold line, MnDOT doesn't want to run it. MnDOT doesn't want anything to do with it. The Met Council has made it clear they don't want to run it. They don't want to own the infrastructure. Who's going to? Washington County doesn't want to do it. It's going to be hugely expensive. The cities don't want to do it. That question's not been answered. My contacts at MnDOT tell me that they don't think this could get FTA funding. The ridership's not there. They don't think FTA is going to be involved in this at all. So in the end, where are they going to get the rest of that money? Where are they going to get the federal money? That's not going to come from the FTA. These are all questions you have to be answered. Again, I'm not opining one way or the other. I'm really laying out concerns that have been brought forward by a lot of people. People that are inside MnDOT, people that are inside on the Met Council. There's a lot of concern about this line. My concern is you wind up with an albatross around your neck, like Anoka has, Anoka County has with Northstar. Ridership's off, can't get it up. It's expensive to run. We're spending $45.17 per rider as a subsidy on North Star. That's unacceptable, but we don't have a choice. We have to run for at least 50 years because we took FTA funding to build it. So for 50 years, we're gonna be running a line that's losing a lot of money and not carrying people functionally because it's Burlington Northern's track and they wanna move oil. They wanna move other product. So we don't get to move enough people. That's a whole different subject. I'm not gonna drone on about that now, but I'll stand for questions when we're done here. Please know that I'm not here to lambast Washington County Commissioners. They're hardworking people. They do the same job I do. I get to work with them regularly at the Solid Waste Management Coordinating Board, at the County's Transit Improvement Board, at the Mosquito Control District, all these different joint powers. I work with that group. They're good people. They want the gold line. They're not happy I'm here. And I told them, I'm not gonna tell them it's a bad line. I'm just gonna lay out facts. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you for inviting me. Folks, thanks for coming out tonight. I'm State Representative Jerry Hertas. I do live out in Greenfield, which is diagonally all the way on the other side of the town, very far northwest corner of Hennepin County. I also am married. I have my wife, Sharon. We've been married for 43 years. We were very young when we got married. We had a few kids. We thought we were adults, but we were really children raising children. And you find out the hard knocks of life, what it's like to make ends meet. I spent most of my career, although I had training in healthcare industry, I was a married college student paying my way, and I was working in the construction trades and eventually became a custom home builder and a developer and a real estate broker. And my concerns about the transit issue are as it relates to the industry that I've been involved with. And you know, when you think about transit, you think about, well, how does it serve its need? And real estate, probably next to healthcare, which I was also in, is probably one of the most regulated industries. And we suddenly found that, you know, the Metropolitan Council in particular started out as a younger man. I remember seeing on my property tax statement, Metropolitan Sewer and Water Commission. And then it metamorphosed into transportation, and it just kept growing and growing. And it started out, it was supposed to be a bottom-up type of organization where communities and cities were reporting to a regional planning authority on how best to have efficient use of extending sewer and water services out to accommodate growth, to accommodate development into these communities. But over a period of time, rather than a bottom up and hearing from the communities and serving those communities, it became kind of an inverted wedding cake, kind of a top down organization. And so suddenly these communities were having to submit plans, and they were having to get the plans approved, and they had to have the blessing of that council. And it's almost as though this unelected body, through, as Mr. Schulte mentioned, served at the pleasure of the governor, seems to give the governor this extra power in a regional way to exert where growth and where development happens. Well, in the case of the real estate industry, when sewer and water couldn't come to an area because they would not approve it. What happened in the industry is we started to leapfrog out beyond the Met Council's jurisdiction. And so the very thing that they were trying to control back in the 70s and 80s, the so-called urban sprawl, which really, you know, didn't answer the free market where people wanted to go, by restricting growth and restricting development and curtailing the amount of land that could be developed created a land shortage within their jurisdiction. And so suddenly prices of lots start to go up. And then accordingly, we go beyond their jurisdiction because, you know, back in the days when there were normal interest rates at 7 or 8%, mortgage dollars were about $7 a thousand. And if you could save $50,000 on a lot, at $7 a thousand, that's $350 a month less payment for your home. And so is it any wonder in a free market why people move further out? And if you think about the qualification for a mortgage at that $350 a month, you'd have to have roughly three times or about $1,000 a month more income to qualify for that same home. So coming full circle, what has happened? I mean, the Met Council wanted to control growth and prevent it from spreading, but the very manner in which they approached the problem created the problems that occur. And so there's some documentation in the Ventura days that part of the plan was to create managed congestion so that you would all support transit. But using the home building analogy again, how does mass transit allow us to build your home? We need roads and bridges. How do the cubes of block get delivered to the hole? How does the lumber get delivered? Is everybody supposed to ride mass transit? Are they information people? They shuffle information? Then the other thing that just came about through this evolution and frustration with it is that I became planning commission member and then eventually chair. I served as the planning commission chair in our community for about 7 years and then became the mayor. And then you realize how heavy-handed this organization has become. Now, currently, the newest plan, Thrive 2040, is now seeming to claim authority over housing. There's no legislative authority giving that council that power and control over a housing plan. But now, in order to get your plan updates that are done on a regular basis approved, you have to have a component of housing that is consistent with the visions and the goal of this unelected regional authority. Now, I've challenged some of the Met Council members as to why do you think you have authority over housing? And they will openly admit, no, we're not claiming that at all. We don't have authority over housing. But they use coercion. If they have a thing called a community score. If you're going to get Met Council resources, you have to have a positive community score. And to get a positive community score, you have to accept your fair share of low-income housing. So this really makes you start to wonder about this organization in terms of the structure and the power they have. They have levy authority. As we heard about the transportation issues, sometimes we get too wrapped around the axle about the capital cost of something, we don't think about the long-term cost of maintaining and keeping it going. A couple weeks ago, I was with Governor Pawlenty, and he had a rather interesting analogy. He said, you know, most things are kind of in a triangle. Over here on one side, you have conservatives who are concerned about freedom and liberty and choice. And over on this corner, you've got, you know, people that are worried about equality. And then maybe up at the top, you've got efficiency. And probably just about any issue you could think of could fit within that triangle. And that's maybe where the ideological debate starts, especially at the Capitol. On one hand, if you've got equality, it's kind of hard to have efficiency. And way over on this side, if you've got freedom of choice in the case of mass transit, what are your choices and options if you're supposedly going to get these great jobs on transit-oriented development? You're only going to have access to the jobs that are located along that corridor. But with roads and bridges and investments made there, and the freedom to drive your car when you want to drive it, where you want to go, meet the schedule or demands of your employer, not the bus schedule, or in the case of light rail, having transit-oriented development. We heard about picking winners and losers. That's exactly what the scheme would be. So with that, I'm really troubled about the massive amount of money that they're talking about. When you look at the vision of what the whole regional mass transit scenario is coming from this body, currently just three LRT lines are losing $55 million a year out of the general fund. They have plans for an immediate six more lines and a total build out somewhere in the area of 12. If you extended that rate of operating loss, not to even mention the capital improvement, if you extended that out times 12, that's basically four times that amount of money, and that's today's dollars, you're talking about $250 million a year that the state is supposed to pick up in operating losses. We heard about the commitment of the FTA, and then you got to run that for 50 years. So what does that mean? It's going to, as a mayor, as a legislator, I'm on the property tax committee. We traveled all around the state last winter asking people about the property tax, and there's a lot of misinformation and messages that, you know, the metro is going to pay for this train, and let Hennepin County pay for the train, or let CTIB pay for the train. But the sad reality is every taxpayer in the state of Minnesota is going to be on the hook for these operating losses. And that money's got to come from the general fund, so other priorities are going to be challenged, whether it's funding education, whether it's money for judiciary, whether it's money for public safety. And ultimately, it will lead to higher taxes. It means more of your money, more of your treasure. And so I think that's really the troubling issue for me. And the capital cost of building this out, eventually rails and trains and all these things do wear out, but lanes, more lanes. If you travel around the country, you see a lot of other regional areas with communities our size, and I think we've been pretty shortchanged in terms of building out our roadways. You can travel all around the country, and it's a little bit easier to get around. So with that, I'll hold for questions too, but thank you very much.
Runbeck. I'm currently state representative and a chair of the House Subcommittee on Metropolitan Council Accountability and Transparency. And the concern I share with, I'm certain many of you in the audience, is that we've got a regional planning organization, the Met Council, that is growing in its taxing authority and is growing in its regulatory power to really control every citizen and every municipality, every local government in the metro area. And we were asked to talk about how did we get here, and the Met Council is just one of the entities that's involved with planning and funding transit. So I'll just mention one key interesting fact. The legislative auditor, when he studied transit governance, said that there are 22 different agencies, including such as the Anoka County Regional Rail, the Washington County Regional Rail Authorities, all of which have some form of taxing authority. So they begin by spending the money at the local, at the county level. And the example of that is Southwest Light Rail, which has already expended $140 million before any shovel has been lifted. And that's basically coming without any legislative oversight, any legislative authority. They're spending those dollars out of property taxpayers' funds to get to those initial stages of planning and design before there's ever any meeting of the public virtually. So it's a process that confounds and makes very frustrated most people that are in touch with it. But I'm gonna talk about one sort of initial or additional piece to the whole puzzle, and the concern is that a lot of us share has been elevated since the Met Council released and adopted the Thrive 2040 plan for the area. And this is a 30-year plan which helps guides the development of the area, the growth and development. And they're called guidelines. These are guidelines in this 681-page document of the 2040 plan. But most of us think the word guidelines sounds rather benign. But I think a lot of you, the ones particularly from Lake Elmo, know that the Met Council doesn't mean it in a benign way. These are guidelines that are to be enforced. They'll go to court, they'll win in court, and they'll force cities to do as they wish to have happen. And so the Thrive MSP 2040 plan is now in effect. It was adopted in late 2014, I believe. And now all the cities in the metro area are going to begin, I believe in 2017, to revise and update their comprehensive plans, which describe how they're going to develop. And they're going to rely then on the guidelines from the MSP 2040 plan. I'm going to focus on just the transportation policy plan within that, and that also was voted on separately by the Met Council and has been approved. 122-page plan which spells out goals, objectives, and strategies for basically transportation, but much of which is transit. And you should know that many of these goals, objectives, and strategies in the TPP are mandated by the federal government's MAP 21. That's their latest transportation funding law. So the stated purpose of the TPP is to connect to communities and foster regional prosperity. The TPP seeks to align development patterns and transportation investments. So it's going to focus investment along corridors and potential for jobs and population growth. The TPP will use transit investments to shape development. The TPP is going to seek to provide more transportation choices. And you'll notice it's not talking about alleviating congestion. That's one of the very interesting notes about this plan. There isn't any effort, not going to be made any effort to relieve congestion. This is about giving people transportation choices. And those are in the area of driving, transit, bicycling, and walking. You'll see those four options all throughout the document. Driving, transit, bicycling, and walking. New language, for the first time, the TPP is elevating the important role of land use and development planning, and it intends to advance the outcome of guiding investments. And I think many of our elected officials at the local level are concerned here, because what they really understand that to mean is that resources from Met Council will be withheld from them if they are but not going to be in compliance with various parts of the plan. The TPP also elevates equity as a key outcome. It also says it's moving the region forward regarding the impact of the transportation system on global climate change. The TPP is considering two funding scenarios, the current revenue scenario and the increased revenue scenario. So the current revenue scenario is using the existing gas tax, MVES tax, and so on and so forth. But the difference between the two revenue scenarios is what they are calling the unmet funding need. So in the roads area, the unmet funding need is about $8 to $10 billion over the 10-year period, so about $1 billion a year for roads. The unmet funding need for transit, they're saying, is about the same amount, $7 to $9 billion over the 10-year period, specifically dedicated to transit, and that is not buses. None of this is talking about buses. That's a whole separate category, separate funding. What none of these documents tell you is that, in the end, we're still going to see that only about 3% of all trips are taken via transit, while 97% of all trips taken are via automobile. And yet, we're looking at funding which is roughly equal, billions of dollars. And I want to just address the issue of the transit tax. I think you're all aware we currently are paying a quarter of a cent transit tax in the metro area. And that is strictly dedicated to transit, and CTIB, which you sit on, County's Transit Approval Board, has that funds to use for their development and operations. But the governor then, in his plan developed in 2015, the funding request that he made was to additionally add another 0.75 cents transit tax in the metro area to pay for transit. Now, just multiply that out, that generates about $950 million a year, and that would more than cover the capital investment that the transit planners want, plus the shortfall in the operating revenues. But it's a huge, huge number. My belief about it all is that what Met Council and CTIB are trying to advance is to become completely autonomous and independent from any oversight except the governor's. They would have a completely funded agency unto themselves, not elected, by the way, not elected, and would be autonomous and would not have to suffer through legislative oversight. I think that is an incredibly dangerous area to allow them to go. The state, as you know, we had a $1 billion bonding bill that was served up, ready to go, with a lot of important water infrastructure projects, roads and bridge projects, college building renovations and investment. And that was only $1 billion, okay? That all got, you know, scoped out, vetted, toured, we toured it to see what those projects were. And you're telling me that we're gonna spend, you know, $5 billion, $10 billion to develop transit and nobody's gonna have any oversight upon that? So, you know, to me it's a, I'm very happy that we did not end up funding a new additional transit tax and setting that agency off on its own. We've already heard a little bit about the cost comparisons, so we won't go into that, but I think Southwest Light Rail is a perfect example. It's $100 million a mile. You have the Orange Line, which is an example of wonderful transit, cost effective, and that's about, I think you said, $12, $15 million a mile. So you have a vast array of choices. And you know, right now we're not being given the option to really look at cost effective ways to give ourselves transit and provide transit for those folks who need it. Let's see, I think that's roughly where I'm gonna end it. We you know, are looking and hoping, a lot of folks are hoping to be able to reform the way transit is governed and to put more sense and accountability into the design and the planning and the funding of the different transit needs that we have, because granted, we do have them. But we also have to be concerned about really what these plans are offering, and again, the ridership. The Southwest Light Rail at $1.8 billion is actually only going to serve 6,500 new-to-transit riders. The key verbiage is new-to-transit. The feds look at that. They want to bring new people to transit. So many folks in the Southwest area have a great express bus that they're already taking. So here you are spending roughly $300,000 per new additional transit rider to provide and construct that transit vehicle. We have to be a lot smarter about this, folks, and hopefully we'll have an opportunity with help from groups like yourselves to get on with it and do it in the right way. Thanks very much.
Thank you so much. That's really interesting. Appreciate it. So if you have questions, please write them down on the cards, and then if you could kind of hold them up, then we're going to collect them. So,
and then if you if I could just ask some of these questions and direct them, is that okay?
We're great, great, great. You got some?
Yeah, I have some. This audience, what a wonderful crowd. It's one of my favorite people on the stage these days. Amazing. And
can
you guys
hear?
Are amazing.
Can you hear? Can everybody hear you?
Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Well, you guys are amazing. Thank you for all being here. It's a wonderful congregation. And one of the first questions I want to ask is of Mr. Pafko. Am I saying your name correctly?
Pafko.
Pafko. I'm sorry.
What was the old, old world pronunciation?
You are a person who has told me that you know how to frugalize and you know how to put all kinds of whistles and bells. And so I have a question here. The proposed cost of the new route is $460 million. What is the cost of the new bridge at Elmo over 94? So what they would do is put a, it's a two-lane bridge now, and they want to build it into a, you know, bigger lane. So if you were going to frugalize four lanes, what would you do? And if you're going to whistle and bell it, how much would it be?
Well, that's, don't know what their design costs are, but generally speaking, a new bridge. Now, is this over a freeway or just
over the freeway?
Okay. You're going to do something in the $5 to $7 million range for a brand new bridge. I'm thinking of what we paid with inflation, what we did for the Edgerton Bridge over Unweave the Weave, and that's where we span 12 lanes of freeway traffic.
It's no exits or entrances?
No, just the bridge.
Okay.
Could you repeat that again?
Okay. A new bridge. And in case of, and I'm looking at that, say a four-lane bridge without shoulders, but just a four-lane city bridge, or two lanes with shoulders, it works out to be about what they would do for a bus route over a freeway. I'd put in the $5 to $7 million range for that bridge.
Okay,
That's your frugal cost.
That's the bulk, that's what a highway, yeah, what a standard road bridge would cost. Yep.
Okay, this is a...
No bells and whistles.
This is 694, and it's a six lane across there. It's a long bridge.
Okay. It would be a long bridge. Like I said, Edgerton over was a six lane span, or 12 lane span, 16 direction.
Thank you. So here I have another question is, I'll save that for the last, but... So, how do you get the Met Council out of the governor's control?
Yeah.
I guess we want to address that.
Well, I think, seeing as I've worked on this for the last 2.5 years, I probably have a little bit of insight. It's not going to happen until we get a different governor. This governor clearly will not sign legislation that takes away his power. No governor in his right mind will do that. You need to have somebody that's going to campaign on the idea of a reformed Met Council. And then you need to elect that guy who's campaigning. So really, this is a lost cause until our 2018 election. You need to start leaning on people now that you know are gonna run for governor and tell them that the reform of Met Council is critical. because you can get the House to pass a bill, you can get the Senate to pass a bill. And if the governor doesn't sign it, it can come back, but it's not gonna be overwritten. It's going to be a veto, and it's not going to be overridden. So what we're leaning on, what we're working on, is that next candidate, be it DFL or Republican, that's willing to say, the Met Council is broken, the process is broken, we need to find a way to match up with every other metropolitan planning organization across the country. There are hundreds of Met Councils across the country. There is only one that has appointed representatives. Every other one across the country has elected people on their body.
Well, thank you. And I agree with everything that was just said, but I also would add that even if we had alternating terms and had elected officials, the Met Council with a $1 billion budget with over 3,500 people working for it, I can assure you of my own experience in my community as mayor, even though we had a rotation of new appointments and new people, they come with the deer in the headlight look in your community. You start asking questions, they're new, they don't understand. Folks, the Met Council is staff driven. It really is staff driven. And I don't believe that electing people to it is really going to change too much. It might make you feel good that you got to elect somebody to take your money, but it still isn't going to change. I would submit that a bigger issue might be to break the whole thing up. And even if there was a regional authority that existed, it shouldn't have control over so many different aspects of our lives. We had divestiture of a phone company back in the late 70s, early 80s, and it was called Baby Bells rather than a big one. And I don't think we need to have the same group of people, a bunch of autocrats, who are kowtowing to somebody's ideology about what it is. I think the more organizations you have, if you had a separate transit commission, if you had a separate different authorities, sewer and water, but really this thing has become so upside down that communities like ours, you know, we're part of the Met Council, we're part of their jurisdiction. They make us conform to their system plans, but they provide nothing to our community. We have no regional sewer and water, other than a little corner in our community to service some lakeshore that comes out of Medina. There's no plan to bring sewer and water for at least 25 or 30 years. There's no bus service. There's really nothing in their system plans that justifies a community that I was representing to be part of the Met Council. And so anyway.
I have another question here, and it's what types of jobs will be you know, provided on the, or added on this route? I presume we could talk about any route, but if we talk about this gateway or gold mine, I mean, what types of jobs would we anticipate could actually be there? You know, I guess transit-oriented jobs or development, I mean, what would they be? Would they?
Well, one of the things in the Thrive 2040 plan is talking about transit-oriented development. And there seems to be this notion that if you build this transit line, whether it's BRT or whether it's a light rail line, that all this commercial development is going to happen along it. And when you look to Seattle, when you look to Portland, when you look to other major regional areas that have actually gone down this path and tried this experiment, they find that the development community isn't interested in being the first pioneer on the block to come there. And so it only happens with more of your tax dollars. It has to be subsidized. So now the building and development that occurs along there needs subsidies, and that, by the way, is happening right now along University and some of the other lines. You know, they claim all this development, that they're using University as an example, that there's been over $4 billion of development because of the line along University. The question is, how much of that would have occurred anyway without the line? And then it's rather unrealistic to claim that every permit pulled for six blocks on either side of the line is attributable to the rail. That's nonsense. I mean, I'm in the building business, it's nonsense. Stuff wears out. People pull permits to put a new roof on. People pull permits to add onto their home. Businesses finally are seeing some economic relief and starting to come out of the recession and are wanting to do stuff. So there's no quantitative way to know how that's happening. And the transit-oriented development simply won't happen on its own in a free market.
I will anecdotally tell you that there is no transit-oriented development that is not subsidized on the North Star Line. We do have TODs, we do have some development, but it was all heavily subsidized by communities in the county. Whether that changes through time, I don't know. The line started operations in 2009. We're before long coming up on its 10th anniversary, so we're all hoping something changes.
When I was working on highway projects, and we were analyzing cost-benefit analysis, the economists told us that we could not claim as a benefit economic development of putting in like a freeway interchange or whatever. And the reason is the economy of the region, their portion of the gross national project determines how much development is going to occur. The only thing a transportation project can do is get the developers to say, we're going to build it here because we got good transportation versus over here. So it doesn't add new jobs, it just concentrates them in an area. As a result, it creates winners and losers.
I'm going to try and pull out a question here. I think it's kind of been answered, but it says, what is projected annual operating and maintenance cost? I guess you kind of answered that already. If you want to address it a little again and recapitulate it, that'd be fine.
What I'll say, in terms of the operating costs, I haven't seen any good estimates on the goal line. That analysis is typically done in a financial analysis for the final EIS, so we've got good numbers for Bottineau and Southwest because those were just completed. But yeah, the goal line is just working on the draft EIS, so I haven't seen comparable numbers on that yet. There may be estimates, but.
I've got another question, probably in your lineup, and this is kind of, you know, it's kind of rather pertinent to this particular. It says here a church is being told they have to put in a $15,000 holding tank for runoff when they resurface their existing parking lot, and how will these dedicated lane additions affect that runoff? I guess, is that something that you can understand or a question you can?
Yeah, well, watershed districts, to try to control runoff. Whenever you have a project that adds new impervious surface,
They do a hydraulic calculation and say you need to provide a certain amount of ponding area to hold that, so you can't, you're not gonna, when it rains on a farm field, a lot of it sinks in when it rains on grass. When it rains on concrete, all of it runs off, so you're creating more runoff quicker. So you want to have a holding pond to slow that down. So it's one of the additional regulations. The Met. Whoever builds the gold line is going to have to do those same hydraulic calculations and build holding ponds as part of the construction.
Okay, thank you. I've got a question here. Is that I don't know if I should really ask this, but I think I'll put it out there, and maybe later on we can get some input from people who are here or might want to talk later. But this questioner asked, I'd like to know what our local legislative position is on gold line and Met Council, and I don't want to put anybody on the spot out here, but I'm not sure that our representatives can put in anything on that or not.
I could probably answer that.
Well, go ahead.
So the state senator and the state representative that represent Oakdale and Woodbury are all in favor of the project. Does that answer the question?
That will answer it. And we would like them to be not in favor, if I can say that. Okay, here's a good question. What would it take to stop this insanity? I think you've all referred to it already. We got to get a governor, and we got to get people in elected office who can stop this. Is that right, or am I wrong on that?
That would help. Elected officials that no longer support this project. That could be at the governor, that could be at the legislature, it actually is mentioned by Scott. Washington County is really in control of this right now.
Yeah.
The county commissioners. The other way, absent a political solution, the Southwest light rail line right now has to get through at least one very good lawsuit and possibly another one.
Right.
So there is always, and being the environmental guy and was one of the support staff for defending the Stillwater Bridge in its lawsuits way back in the 90s.
Yeah.
Environmental lawsuits can be very effective. But the other way that we've talked about, I'm calling it the death spiral. As you build more transit lines and have to take more operating costs, you have much less money available for capital costs. So one of the things is starve transit funding. There was a push, there will be pushes to increase that quarter cent sales tax to a full penny, full 1%. And if that happens, then this full build out's going to occur. So, starve the beast.
Can I have the microphone?
Go ahead. I'm just going to chime in on that. It does come down to funding is the big issue. And, they're running short of funds. There's beginning to be a very desperate need for this transit tax. And the House, if the membership of the House of Representatives remains the same and the Republicans remain in the majority, I'm very confident we'll continue to say no to an additional Metro Transit tax. I think we're going to see a lot of pressure to convert the House to Democrat control this time around. There'll be a lot of money spent because I think the governor's bet was in this whole charade of trying to get this funding for Southwest Light Rail was that trying to make the Republicans look bad so that they can regain control of the House, so they can control the funding and shoot that new money right to the CTIB and the planners and the Met Council. So it all hangs on the election and the election results this year.
Can I ask a question?
Why don't you write out what you have? Yeah, bring it up here, please. Bring up your questions.
I'd like to just ask.
Well, why don't you bring up your questions? Would you mind doing that? Please do that. Please. We'd like to maintain some decorum here, and also that other question.
I promise not to upset.
I heartily encourage you to come up here. And
I want to know what the basis is in law that allows an unelected body to levy taxes. That's what I want to know.
Okay, that's a good question, and I guess you guys could maybe go into that. You heard the question?
I did hear the question. I'll repeat it for everybody. What in law allows an unelected body to levy taxes? In 1991, Dave Dernberger, at the federal level, put it into a federal highway bill that the Metropolitan Council in the state of Minnesota could be appointed by the governor on a short-term basis until they could facilitate an election. That exemption carried through all the way until October of 2014. In October of 2014, that exemption expired. And the Federal Highway Administration refuses to enforce it. The way they would enforce it would be by not releasing federal highway dollars to Minnesota. So it's a huge risk. If we ask highway to enforce it, federal highway to enforce that lack of exemption, to force Minnesota to have an elected Met Council, and it's really not the Met Council, it's the MPO, the Metropolitan Planning Organization, which is our TAB, or Transportation Advisory Board, which is advisory to the Met Council. I'm not gonna get way down in the weeds because this gets really hard to comprehend when you get down there, but what it amounts to is we had an exemption passed by David Dernberger back in 91 that allowed us to have an appointed Met Council. FHWA has sent a letter to the Met Council saying, you are not in compliance. We expect you to get into compliance, but we have no teeth in this law, so do whatever you want to do. That's essentially what the letter said. It's unfortunate. We continue to work with Federal Highway through our Congress folks from Minnesota to see if we can get some relief from the Federal Highway level. But at the same time, we don't want federal funding cut off. We're hoping that it would scare our governor enough to form a more effective Met Council. Now, I agree with Representative Hertas that scrambling the whole system and coming up with state agencies to do this work instead of an appointed Met Council would probably be more effective, but I don't think that will ever happen. I think we are going to have a Metropolitan Council. Well, it's the only way we can get federal dollars. The federal government can't allocate money to state agencies. They have to allocate to elected officials. That's where Minnesota got its exemption. That's where they continue to operate in a fashion where they are an unelected body that can levy taxes. It's unfortunate, but that's the reality. Oh, just one more clarification. Representative Runbeck said that we were operating under Map 21 recently. That is now over. Map 21 was moving ahead for progress in the 21st century. That was the highway bill that was passed 70 years ago. It's currently called the FAST bill, Fixing America's Surface Transportation. It's a 6-year highway bill with 5 years of funding from the federal government. I'm still waiting where that last year is going to come from, I'm not sure.
Thank you. I hope you can all hear me, and I apologize for not. I thought I had a loud voice, and I think I must have something that's brought there or something. But can you all hear me now?
Yes. Yep.
Okay, here, this is a kind of a question, I think it's kind of an insider's question, and I don't know how to, but I'm going to ask it anyhow. Does anyone know Mr. Baudette's stance on BRT? And I guess we'd have to ask someone in the audience who that is, and he's running against Gary Creasel, and I guess that's a Washington County position, and I'm going to break the rule here, and if there's someone who can elaborate on this, I'm going to invite them to take the microphone and do it. Are you the person?
I don't know.
Who gave you this question?
I don't know the answer.
Okay, is Mr. Baudette someone who is running?
Against Gary Creasel.
Okay, and we would like to know that because that is a very important thing. If we could get, and my colleagues and I have been down to that particular Washington County area, and we've talked to them a lot, but you know, we haven't had very good results in getting them to change their stance on that. And so anyhow, we'll try and find that out and get that known.
Yeah, we're a nonpartisan group, so we can't tell you who to vote for, but I would really strongly urge you, you can go to the Secretary of State website and you can find out the candidates that are running for the county commission for any role. Click on their name, you can find their phone number, their email, their website. I really encourage people to call the candidates and ask them how they stand on things that they feel are important before you vote.
Thank you, Linda. Here's a good one. I don't know how you want to approach this, but driving habits and preferences seem to be changing. Well, this is all debatable in my estimation, I want to say, especially among millennials. And they either cannot afford, which I think is the big thing, or are less inclined to own cars. I think from what I know of them, they want to buy them, they can't afford it. That's my own opinion. And how do we accommodate this apparent desire? I think we get a better economy. So can I answer that question for everybody? You want to leave it there? Okay, thank you. Thank you for your question. Okay, Met Council grants and funding are important to local cities. I guess they are. How do you break that dependency? I'm not sure the grants, are there Met Council grants? Is it there grants? So, okay. Can you guys elaborate on that? How do we get rid of that dependency and reform the process?
Well, that's an incredibly detailed answer. I don't know that we can get into it. I can tell you that cities are reliant on Met Council dollars, but those dollars would be there whether the Met Council was or not. You could have a formula. You could add it to the LGA formula, local government aid. You could add it to the county's program aid formula. There's lots of ways to dispense those dollars rather than meeting contrived criteria of livable communities that the Met Council comes up with. So there are ways to get that money out there. I don't think that the Met Council necessarily needs to be the body that distributes it.
Okay, I'll get into the next.
Thank you, I'll get into the next question here. Is this why they still tax our Social Security? I don't know how that figures into all this, but I'm not sure about that. But it's a good question, and really, as all of our state representatives, I suppose that you're on the ones who would want to give us the freedom from being taxed on Social Security. I mean, I don't know, I hope you would, but I hope everyone here would want to do that. It's hard to believe I'm on Social Security, I know that, but I want this to happen. Okay, I've got one more question here. And I'm going to try and answer it myself because our panel has been just wonderful. You guys are just so terrific, your presentations and everything. And I've got this other last question. Does this have any tie-in? I guess this is the whole deal down here in the Gateway Quarter with a proposed casino on 4th Street towards Hudson, Manning, and Street and Vision. And I would say absolutely not. This casino thing, and if anybody knows any different, let me know because this. I think there's been a purchase of land there, but I think they just buy land and they do it all the time. And my informants tell me that this outfit that bought the land, they're just adding 600 or 700 rooms down in their main operation. They buy land because it's a thing to do, because they got the money and they do it. So if anyone wants to counter that, I'd be happy to hear the counter, but I don't think that's it. Okay? That's the last question. Thank you all very much. Oh, one more? One more. How does the emerging revolution in something automatic driving for both cars and transit vehicles figure into our planning for the future? The future, yeah. There we are, we're building this old stuff. You guys know it, it's old, it's stuff that should have been thrown in the junkyard long ago. We've got all kinds of new devices and, you know, smart things. I mean, this, what, do you want someone to speak to that?
I think a lot of high technology, high tech stuff is happening. Even buses that are kind of from Uber, operated by Uber apparently. You also have telecommuting. I mean, we really haven't explored the opportunities in telecommuting that are another, way of saving the wear and tear on the roads and keeping people, at their desks instead of on the road. So there's a lot of things that haven't been factored in, it seems to me, into this this plan. And there's a tremendous desire to build out. And truthfully, I mean, these light rail projects do, improve the looks of neighborhoods. I mean, I guess there's no question about that, but I think we can get that done in far better ways and far cheaper ways.
From a highway perspective, if you turn the driving of your vehicles over to a computer, theoretically, you're going to able to vastly increase the capacity of your existing infrastructure, get two or more times as many vehicles down that lane of traffic than you do today. So as that technology goes, we can, if we can in fact improve the capacity of an additional lane, you don't have to build more lanes.
That's a good question, and I think we've already started to see quite a bit of it happening. The internet changed the way we live. A lot of people now have in-home offices. They have flexibility with their employers to deal with issues before rush hour. A lot of people do plan their day accordingly around the transportation patterns. And I know even with regard to shopping, even the online shopping, I don't know about some of you folks, but there seems to be a box at the end of my driveway about every third day. But anyway, it means you don't have to drive and do some of these things. We are going through changes, and modern technology is doing that. And I certainly do think that driverless cars is something maybe some of us in this room may not see, but probably the millennials certainly will. And as we heard, it does increase efficiency.
As a politician, this will surprise you, but I'm not going to answer that question. I'm going to answer a different one. I want to get back to the question that somebody asked about the millennials. And they don't want to buy cars, and they don't have cars. You know, I got a 27-year-old daughter who's never taken a driver's test, doesn't have a driver's license, and gets around perfectly fine. She lives in Portland, Oregon, doesn't take the train. She takes buses and Uber everywhere. And she's been doing it since she was 19 years old. What I'm trying to say really is, buses are really the key to mass transit. They're so much more flexible than a train, so much more flexible than even a guideway BRT. Because if all of a sudden that bus is only half full, and then it's a quarter full, you've wasted that infrastructure. You've wasted the build out of that guideway. Where if you were just running a bus on an express lane on the highway, and it's only a quarter full, and it's not paying for itself, you tell the riders, hey, sorry, we can't run this one anymore. We're gonna run it somewhere else. You got flexibility, you can move it. Now, people will argue you don't get economic development that way because businesses want that dedicated guideway because they know their customers are gonna be there. Well, tell that to North Star riders. Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming. I really appreciate your attention. I want to thank our panel. I really appreciate it. It was very interesting. You're very enlightening. And if you haven't seen, there's like a little pink sheet if you live in the area. They are looking for input now. They're going to make a decision on the route by December 8th. So there's going to be a public hearing, and there's a chance to put comments in. So if you want to make comments on the gateway, just don't say, oh, we don't need it, it costs too much, or whatever. Try to say something specific about how it relates to you or how it would impact you if there's a specific area. The other thing I have this gentleman here, his name is Bob Carney. He's an activist over on the Southwest Light Rail, and he came here on the express bus, and he's wondering if somebody could take him down to Sunray to drop him off so he can take the bus. So if anybody is kind of heading that way or wants
I'll
to get
give you a ride.
Okay. All right, thank you. Have a nice evening. And please eat the cake.